And now we make that smooth segue to make it look like, yes, I just came on camera, giving you the illusion that we are actually in a room with slides behind us for today's California Library Association Ursula Meyer Training Fund session on online presentation skills for library advocates. We will be talking during the session today, and again, a lot of conversation around this, so you walk out with skills you can use. For those of you watching the archive version, at the points where we do exercises here, feel free to just stop the recording, do the exercise, come back into it, so that at the end of this, you, like the people participating live today with us, walk away with an action plan, a presentation outline for something you can do in the near future, like within the next couple of weeks, to put you in the position to be an effective presenter online as a library advocate. Having done that, the thing I want to point out here is this is something you can do through Zoom where you have your slides as your background. It requires a little bit of adjustment up front. You certainly want to play with this before you try using it live in front of an audience. But once you get familiar with it, it's not that hard to use. And I will go back and forth so that you can see the process a little bit during today's presentation. Now, all that said, let's dive right into the heart of what we're talking about here. Advocacy in an online environment. Those of you who have followed social issues over the last 5 or 6 or 7 years, and I can't imagine any of you in library land are not doing that, you know that there are wonderful things going on in advocacy. And it's been pushed to the limit in some ways, a positive limit, over the last couple of years because of what COVID's done to us, forcing us to move quickly from primarily face-to-face interactions to primarily online interactions. And now we're finally moving back into what some of us have been doing for quite a while, which is combining our face-to-face and online interactions in ways that make them seamless and comfortable for those involved. That's what we're going to focus on today. What are some of the tips, the things you have to watch for, the practice things that you have to do? But as I think about these things, I think of somebody that I think is the epitome of moving from a face-to-face situation to online in a situation we're all familiar with. Ferguson, I believe it was 2014 when Michael Brown was shot. Media all over the country was covering that, but saying a guy was shot because he was accused of stealing stuff from a convenience store. And he laid out there for several hours in the street while the police were trying to figure out what to do about it. There were a lot of questions up front about that, but really what started to focus was when a guy named D. Ray McKay, who was an educator, I believe out of Minnesota, looked at that and thought, something isn't right here. And he was curious enough and socially aware enough that he wanted to go on site and see what was happening. He wasn't, I guess, trustful enough that the media was putting things out there in a way that was presenting it in a way that made sense to people. So McKesson went on site and he started tweeting from Ferguson, and that just exploded things. You want to talk advocacy and go to the heart of advocacy? It's something I say in every presentation I do on advocacy these days. And if you were with me over the weekend, last weekend in Sacramento for the California Library Association Conference, you heard me tell the story of a colleague of mine who talks about where advocates start. They don't start because they see a big cause and they want to jump into it. They start like D. Ray McKesson did, looking at something that bothers him and saying, I think I can do something about that, and taking little steps. And D. Ray really showed us what it could be to move into online advocacy by using Twitter as a platform to reach hundreds of thousands of people. That pumped him into the center of advocacy. It pumped the issues he was promoting into the center of advocacy. And he was already obviously well-versed in presentation skills. What he did is what I would encourage all of you to do today. And as you work with the material that we're going to cover and that you explore, take what you already know about good presentation skills on site or any other platform you've been using, carry those into online and understand that what you learn online is going to come back to also benefit you on site. And that gives us what we, in education circles at least, talk about in jargon terms as blended, where something may start on site and then move into an on-site setting. It may start on site and move into it may start online and move into on-site settings. If we stop worrying about where we are and think about the purpose of the work we're doing, we're on our way to being good presenters on-site, online, and in blended environments. Now, I want to really get this going. So for those of you comfortable enough, please turn your cameras on, unmute yourself. Let's do a couple of quick exercises here and talk about some stuff that prime the pump for us. Think about presentations you've seen, particularly in an advocacy setting. Think about a presentation that moved you so much that you took some sort of action. It doesn't have to be world-changing, just something that you attended that was a presentation encouraging you to take action, and you did. And let's talk about what that situation was and why it was effective. Any takers? I've seen in the chat, one of the people on the call has to leave at 10:30. This will be archived. There's a slide deck that goes with it that will be made available to you. So don't sweat it. We're hoping that you'll enjoy this as much as other people are coming in the archived version. But for the live audience here, for those of you watching archived, think about that. The question I just popped to you, a presentation you've seen that was so good, it moved you to action. Why did it move you? Any takers here? Nobody's been moved. Tragic situation.
Paul?
Yes.
Just because I don't like the void of a silence.
That's perfect. And again, presentation tip number one. If you want audience interaction, you wait them out. It's painful the first time, but it becomes very effective. Thank you, Larry.
Well, what I was going to suggest, I can't think of any one instance, but I can think of the cumulative effect of various things that have made me want to continue to advocate as need be. And so maybe that's a way of answering your question.
Absolutely. It's meant to be broad.
Yeah, certainly, you know, trainings have always been very important. Certainly the trainings that you've been doing the last year and a half or so have been very helpful. But also the various other organizations that I belong to that do various advocacy training, such as AALL is a good example. Whenever we're in the DC area, there's always like a half day or full day workshop that includes, you know, how to talk to your legislators or their staff. I've also been to a couple of the ALA advocacy weekends in DC where, again, there's a workshop before you go out, and usually you go out with somebody and you kind of work ahead of time who's going to say what.
So I'm hearing, Larry, that part of the thing that makes these effective is you're actually using what you learn. You go out with somebody.
Right.
You got a mentor that coaches you through it.
Again, I'll just reinforce too, by constantly participating in advocacy sessions such as this, it keeps you up to speed on, and also reinforces your courage.
Wonderful. So let's debrief that just a little bit more. Is there anything else about those things that is a theme running through all of them, Larry, that makes those advocacy sessions really strong for you?
When you're advocating with elected officials or staff, to be as personable as possible. And by personable, I mean, and I think we talked about this last weekend, is get to know the person as best as you can beforehand.
Right.
A good example, when I went to the ALA ones, some of it was sponsored by one of the library organizations, and they asked for a report. So the following year when I went, I dug out my report to read the comments I wrote about the different people I met with and was able to follow up with it.
We often, thanks, Larry, that really nails a lot of the themes I was hoping would come out in this introductory conversation. When we think about presentation, I think for a person that hasn't done a lot of it, first thing that happens is we just get scared to death, literally, of thinking, oh my gosh, I could never, yeah, hands are going up. Surveys have been done. I can't verify whether these are true or not, but I've seen them so long, we all fall into the trap of believing that these are true, well-researched surveys. They show that if you talk to Americans about the number one fear they have, it's speaking in public. I think, but nobody's really ever died of speaking in public. We die of a lot of other things, but not that. And we have this ingrained fear. What Larry's talking about on the personal side, I think, is a good first step toward taking that fear away. When we're going to talk about public speaking or any kind of presentation, face-to-face or online, first thing to think about is that audience. If you think about the people you're talking to, and I'm looking at you all, the faces I can see here, that's why I keep encouraging other people to bring their faces on and keep them on if you're comfortable with it. The more we see each other, the more we get comfortable with each other. And instead of thinking, oh, I'm doing public speaking, this is so frightening, it gets to the idea of you're looking at somebody on a screen and talking to them and hearing them react. You're seeing their facial expression, so you can see the reactions. You can see their body language. If someone's kind of like this, you know that you're sort of losing them, you better up your game. If they are leaning forward and they're looking right at you, or they're taking notes as somebody's doing right now, you know that there's a connection there. And that starts putting the fear of the conversation aside. So another big tip here in doing online or face-to-face conversation is don't forget your audience. When you're planning it, think of who you're going to be speaking to. Think of the things you have in common and why they're going to be interested in what you're talking about. Think of what you want to accomplish through that conversation. These are themes we'll come back to over and over again. And I've got them well noted in the slide deck that goes with this presentation if you want to go back. By the way, I will say this again later, but I don't want to miss the opportunity here in terms of slide decks. Do not please make the mistake of thinking that your slide deck is your presentation. Your slide deck is the tool that gets integrated into the presentation. And the way I'm using it right now in a kind of goofy way is you're not even seeing the deck yet. The deck is really a resource that you can go back to later. It has the main points up on those slides. It has speaker notes that capture very succinctly what I'm sort of rambling about right here at this point. But I see a slide deck as something that is a resource to be used during the presentation, a resource that's shared afterwards so people can go back and see what they want to see. It can be used if it's well done with the speaker notes. It can be used as an asynchronous opportunity for people that don't have access to the video of the session. They can actually go back and look at that slide deck and take from the notes there something that will give them useful information that they can then apply. And later on, we will, if we don't run out of time, and I don't forget to do this, I'm going to try to take you at least to one colleague's site to show you how radically wonderful slide decks can get in terms of being part of your advocacy pitches. If you create them and post them on a website that is accessible to people, in case I forget to come back to this, jot down, please, the name Tom Hames, H-A-Y-M-E-S, again, H-A-Y-M-E-S. His website is ideaspaces.net. Again, it's ideaspaces.net. Tom is a consummate educator, presenter, advocate. I know him well through an organization we're both involved in, Shaping EDU. When I saw Tom's slide deck at a live presentation face-to-face 6 or 7 years ago through the New Media Consortium, I just sat back thinking, none of us are doing what Tom's doing. He had his presentation on his site. He brought that up while he was talking. The site focused on Tom and those of us in the room, but we could see that deck behind him. And we knew if afterwards we wanted more, we could go back to the ideaspaces.net site and read that and get more links. That, to me, is really savvy use of our technology. The first and most important thing is what we're doing together today. We're still looking at each other face-to-face online here without letting the deck get in the way, but you know it's there and it's your security blanket. And Tom was very good about creating that kind of thing. That works very well in training, teaching, learning. I think it could also work in advocacy. If you have a large issue that you're working on with lots of people spread over a large geographic area, and you can post these things and make them available. It's the same thing I've done when I worked with the American Library Association, orienting volunteers for the annual conference for positions they were going to do. We would do live sessions like this where I'd use the deck. They would know the deck was there in case they couldn't do the live recorded sessions, so they could go look there. I would bring it on site and do face-to-face sessions with that same deck. So when you are doing your presentation from the very start, think of your audience. Think of what you want to get across to them. Think about how to use the deck effectively. Please, not lots of bullet points and not too much text nobody can read. Make sure that they have big images that foster conversation with just a few words. And a final tip in terms of slide decks, when you're doing presentations for advocacy or any other purpose, I gave up about a decade ago using bullet points at the end to summarize things because a great colleague, Roberto Gianicola, here in the Bay Area, San Francisco Bay Area, Roberto was doing something where instead of putting annotations on his slides for the books he talked about, he had book covers. I thought, wow, you're not looking at endless book lists on a slide where you can't even read it. You can see the cover and it's going to get into your memory. When you go to the bookstore, you're already ahead of the game because you know what cover you're looking for if they haven't changed the cover of it. I started using that in terms of summaries at the end of presentations. I've designed something like that in this presentation if we actually get to the deck, where at the end I pulled 5 or 6 images that were the key images of the deck and put them in so that you saw them go, oh yeah, that was about this. We call that memory anchors. Thank Aaron Blumberg out of Florida for teaching me that idea of memory anchors, where you pull visuals, repeat them as a way of helping people remember things. So these are all things that we think about in big, broad terms as we start preparing our presentations and thinking about how to reach our audience and how to make ourselves connect with people rather than thinking I am in front of a huge room. And if I make a mistake, it's going to be all over the evening news and I will never live this down. And I will be in John Ronson's book, so you've been publicly shamed. That ain't going to happen for the most part. So let us tamp those fears down. And remember, advocacy is personal. As Larry said, advocacy is experiential. You do it and you do it more and you do it more and you get comfortable. And to take it to the heart of things, don't think of advocacy as you going out trying to convince people to do things. Think of advocacy like fundraising, as I so often say. Think of advocacy as offering other people an opportunity to get involved in something that you think is important and they may think is important too. That takes pressure off you. If they say no, okay, you move on to the next person. It was an opportunity that wasn't for them. But if you've clicked with them, like if here in library circles, we talk about how broadband is such an important issue that we have to address. You're concerned about broadband. Other people in your community are concerned about that. If you say, I have this initiative that can help us get expanded broadband and people that are struggling to work and to learn online will benefit from doing this. If you get to another person that's interested, they become a partner in advocacy. If you are interested in diversity issues and somebody else is interested, you're not begging them to join your diversity group. You're saying, I've got some action going where we can produce positive results. Here's what it takes. Get in, it's Huck Finn and the White Fence, right? We just start painting together and we get places. So circling all back, because that's a lot to throw at you. That's like the whole slide deck in the first 10 or 15 minutes of our conversation here together. Advocacy and presentation go hand in hand. It's personal. It is not something to be afraid of. It's not something to be feel bad about if people say no to you. What you want to do is find the people with you who will then help you spread your message. And if you are a good presenter and a good facilitator of conversations, you're going to be surprised by how effectively people rally around you. Let me stop and ask you, what questions does that all raise for you?
So Paul, Larry has his hand up and Miranda has a question in chat.
Thanks. So Larry?
Yeah, it was just something you said when you were talking about the deck struck something that I don't think we really talk about very much when we talk about advocacy, whether it's personal advocacy or whether it's in a group setting. And that is not to be afraid to tell somebody if they ask a question, you know what, I don't know the answer, rather than guess what the answer should be or give a partial answer. And say, I will get back to you, which is actually a good way of being able to continue the conversation rather than just a thank you for meeting with me or whatever, but to actually be able to get back and say, you know, thank you, but also here's the answer. I found out what it is, or let's talk more about this type thing.
That's such a rich set of comments. The first thing is, for this particular group, you're all with libraries, that should be secondhand to you. You know you're not at a ref desk making it up. If somebody asks you something, you don't know the answer, you try to refer them to somebody else who does have the answer, or you tell them that you're going to take the contact information, you'll get back to them, and of course, then you do. Same thing in advocacy. Another issue that Larry's talking about there in terms of making sure that people are with you is, you look for opportunities for engagement. So if you can't answer a question right up front, there's a good excuse to stay in touch later and do a follow-up. Hey, here's the answer you were looking for. By the way, anything else I can help you with? And that's another way to open the door and keep the conversations going. So your advocacy efforts build organically. I know it's another jargon word that a lot of us hate, but it really describes it well. It's a natural progression. And finally, there was another aspect of that I wanted to make about PowerPoint decks. And I think my mind is starting to fade on that issue. Let me see if I can quickly recall it. I'll come back to me later. Larry, thanks for nailing that so well. And the other person who had something they wanted to ask?
The question in chat is from Miranda. Would you recommend one to become a member of Toastmaster? Worth the time?
Miranda, I don't have firsthand experience with Toastmaster. I have wonderful presentation colleagues all over the country who are members of Toastmaster, and they swear by it. I've seen a few of them in action, and they are great presenters. I don't know if that came out of Toastmaster or if it came out of the idea that they are inquisitive people who are always growing, and they are always trying to fine-tune their presentation chops. But anything you can do that gives you practice room and gives you supportive community to encourage you is good. And from that point of view, I would say Toastmasters is probably a great option for you. Larry.
You know, again, the way you said that reminded me of something. If in addition to learning something, it's a way, I know people that are in Toastmasters. I know people that have been, you know, were in Toastmasters 20 years ago that still connect with the people they were in Toastmasters with at the time. So it is one way of building an independent network of people who, you know, when push comes to shove, some of them will be supporters and will help you out and help you make the connections you need to make in advocacy.
Thank you. Marcia or Marcy?
No, I'm a member of Toastmasters. And the good thing about Toastmasters, no one has perfected their presentation skills. So that's the one reason why I'm here. And another reason is also a learning lab. So you get to practice in front of members if you have a presentation somewhere and they will critique you on it. So that's the reinforcement. And it could be a reinforcement for what we're learning today.
Everything that Marcy, Larry, and my other colleagues have told me about Toastmasters tells me it's a really nice thing because you're getting that kind of supportive encouragement that you need, that we all need. And Marcy just said the most brilliant thing that's going to come out of this. You got to be running the session, Marcy. We all need practice. If anybody tells you they have mastered this, they're lying to you. I have not mastered this. I've been working at it a long time. But I would say almost every presentation I go to teaches me something. I watch some great presenters do things and I pick up lines from them. We all joke about stealing from each other, but it really isn't stealing. We all riff off each other and we get better at our presentations, unless we're all telling the same joke, of course, and then we're in trouble. But that whole idea of having a good supportive community is an essential part of becoming an effective presenter online, face-to-face, or in, I think that pretty much covers it, but in the venues that we work in, the more you do, the better you get. One other tip on that, even though I'm a trainer and I adore my trainer buddies, trainers are the worst audience if you're doing a training run through because they will try to second guess everything about what if somebody does this, what if somebody does that. And my experience has been most people in the audience aren't critiquing us at that level. They're there to learn. So be very careful about who you listen to in terms of your critiques. Everything I've heard says Toastmasters is one of those great places to go. I know presenting at the California Library Association Conference, presenting at ALA conferences, at Association for Talent Development conferences, and many other places. When I'm around audiences that are there to hear content and learn from it, they're wonderfully supportive and I learn from their comments. Not to embarrass Larry or anything, but he came up to me a couple of times during the CLA conference saying very nice things about stuff. And I just sort of turned red and sputter a little bit because I appreciate the comments, but it's kind of embarrassing. We got a bunch of people around. So it's just, that was really good because, you go, oh man, that's just such magic in to your ears to get that encouragement. You want to be a great presenter? Go to other presenters and tell them what you liked about their work. That builds. That's really great. Publicly, Larry, thanks again. Those were really meaningful, wonderful comments. What else is coming up for you as a result of what we've said so far here? And a quick reality check. Are you starting to get some tips that will be useful to you in your own presentations? Okay, assuming that's good, let's move into the second part of that, what I called a priming the pump exercise. We talked and thought about presentations that moved us to advocacy or moved us to action. Let's take the opposite tact. What is a presentation that was so bad that you ran screaming from the halls and never wanted to see that organization again? Think of what that was and why it was bad. Let's talk that out. Those of you listening to the archive recording, you have not lost sound. We're just doing what Larry noted before. I'm waiting for somebody to get so uncomfortable that we get a story going.
Well, I'm picking myself. I did a presentation to a group of high school students, and I started off well, that's what my friend said, but when I looked at the audience, I froze. And I lost my words, I lost my thoughts, and it didn't go so well.
What have you done since then to make sure that doesn't happen to you again?
That's the reason, that was one of the reasons I joined Toastmasters.
All right, so
because
there you are.
So that I can practice in front of people speaking without, you know, having anxiety about it and allowing my anxiety through the whole process. I know it happens in the beginning, but once I say something, I should feel comfortable about talking once I do that initial contact, like you said, making the connection.
So again, rich, well worth debriefing set of comments there. The first thing is, she said that there was a situation, she remembered a situation where it didn't work out so well, and she took action. She joined Toastmasters. That doesn't mean everybody who's ever struggled has to go and join Toastmasters, but it does mean at that moment when you bomb, and we all bomb. I think it was Larry who asked me at the conference, have you ever had a bad presentation? Oh yeah. There were things where I thought it was going great, and afterwards just got totally bombarded on the evaluations. There were some things behind it that we didn't know about that helped us to understand, the two of us involved in that, what went wrong and what we could do to fix it. But you will bomb at some point. It's not the end of the world. You just pick up your big boy pants or your big boy skirt. You put the stuff back on. You do what Marcy talked about. Find a supportive group and get back on the horse, because we need you. Your audience needs you. The community you advocate for needs you. You never master this stuff. You can get pretty good at it and have people coming up to you, giving you wonderful ego strokes by telling you how good you are. But please do not believe your own PR. We all can continue to learn, and we should continue to learn. That's a good thing for us to do. Other comments on this? All right, so punchline to what we've just done for the first part of this session together. We talked about what was good, and the punchline is do that. Continue to do that. Learn from others who have done that. If you're struggling, get some help. If you need practice, practice in front of supportive audiences who are honest with you. Supportive doesn't mean that they're not critical, but understand anything that comes back to you in terms of saying, this really turned me off, this could have been better, that's a gift. That's really a gift, because it makes you better. And for those bad things that you recall, like when you bombed on stage or somebody else did something that totally turned you off because they made an off-color comment that made you personally feel bad, and you figured that's not an organization I want to be with. The lesson there is do not ever, ever, ever do that to your own audiences. It comes down to empathy, folks. Great presenters, I think, are empathetic. Great presenters are not the ones that go and speak to halls of 50,000 people at a time and get everybody waving their fists in the air, and then they walk away and the crowd dissipates and nothing comes of it. The great presenters are the ones that connect with an audience, do and say something meaningful, and they inspire meaningful, concrete, measurable results afterwards. Erie McKesson, if he hadn't tweeted, we would have never heard of him, but he did, and it made a difference in Ferguson. We're still talking about that. The people that started the Me Too movement, we're still talking about them. Our local, regional, state, and national advocates were working on broadband and diversity and libraries and lunches that, like we have here in California. So many of the issues we look at, literacy, freedom of information, these are people that care and find other people who care, and through their honest, from the heart communication skills, which don't rely a bit on a great PowerPoint deck, they rely on connecting with an audience. That's where it's at, and the rest of it, the decks, the Zoom meetings, the Google Docs we share to try to inspire action sometimes, these are tools. Always remember, it comes back to people. The technology is a tool, but what we're doing in advocacy and what we're doing in presentation is people to people with a strong goal in mind that you can measure and that you believe in. If you've got that, you're probably going to do very well at your presentations. Thoughts or reactions to that? So let's now really move into what does it mean to be online and present. Have you noticed anything unusual about this presentation in terms of it being a learning opportunity and the tools I'm using with you? Is this like every other session you've been in, or is this one somehow a little bit different? Nobody knows, right? It's like, huh? What's the question? All right, let's start simple. Yes or no? Is this like every other session you've been in? Okay, Larry's in the middle. That's great, Larry. That's good that you're getting to those sessions. I've seen Marcy say no. Marcy, what's making this one a little different for you?
No, I like the interaction. After each presentation, you ask the question to engage the audience, and everything is like empathetic in the way you interact with us to make it seem like you care about us you know, care about the audience doing their presentations. It just seems very personable. That's what I love. Yeah.
And that's, again, I'm doing this very deliberately and I'm calling attention to it so that if you weren't aware of it, you start building that into your own practice and your own presentation style. The worst thing I think you can do to an audience, and now I finally remembered what I wanted to say back about PowerPoint decks. Worst thing you can do to people is lecture them for 59 minutes and say, oh, we have 1 minute for a question. Oh, time's up. Nice seeing you. See you next year. Total bomb. There was no interactivity. There was no room for growth. The tip I wanted to give you earlier about decks is that awful thing I see trainers and presenters so often do, where they've got their deck and they are dedicated to showing every slide in that thing, whether they have time for it or not, and they will rush at the end just like, ah, oh, I made it. I showed you my whole deck. When somebody asks you a question, if it's not in the program and not on the deck, you can waste a lot of time explaining why that's not going to be covered and you're really sorry and all that. Or you can give a one-line answer saying, I'm not prepared to really cover that well, but here's one line that can guide you there. And if you want to follow up with me after the session, send me an email or make a phone call to me or catch me outside the room here and we'll talk. That invitation to continue the conversation is all important. And that's what Marcy's noticing about this. When you look at the deck I've got, let's see if I can actually do a screen share here to go back to the PowerPoint deck and demonstrate something for you. And this takes a little bit of time when we're live, but it's worth the time. And as long as you're talking people through it, like I'm talking you through it, it doesn't feel too painful. And it gives you an opportunity to take advantage of the setting we're in. Now, let's see if within my deck, and this may be the mistake I'm making here, where I want to be able to show you the notes phase of it, but it's not going to do that. Okay, that experiment. So I'm going to take it down and then explain to you what's going on. You know, in PowerPoint, you can look at a deck in its normal outline form where you've got a slide and then the thumbnail's on the left. You can bring it full screen. There is an option within there to look at what they call the slide sorter. And that will show you little thumbnails on one screen of up to 30 or 40 slides at a time. And when you're planning your presentation, that's a good thing to use. I always do that when I'm getting to the final, semi-final stage of codifying a deck. I look to see if I've got a bunch of slides, one after another, that are basically lecture format with no point for interaction. And if I've got more than about 7 or 8 of those, I'll cut in there and put in a conversation or discussion slide. So I'm reminded, and the people I'm working with are reminded, that it's not all lecture. It has to be there. And that's what Marcy's noticing here. Obviously, we're doing this, what I keep calling face-to-face online format, so we can see each other. But if we were looking at the deck, you'd see that in that slide sorter mode, as a presenter, I had said, here's 7 or 8 slides. I want to cover this material. Then we work with it. Here's another 7 or 8 slides, and we're going to work with it. Rule of thumb for me, not based on any firm thing that I can say, this is the only way to go, folks, is if I go more than 5 or 10 minutes talking without some kind of interaction with an audience, whether it's a half hour session, an hour, or 3 hours, I feel like I may be giving people a chance to bail on me, to go check their email, to do something else. But if I'm consistently coming back to people and asking for engagement and offering them a chance to ask the questions that are meaningful to them, they're going to stay with me. As a presenter, I shake my head at other presenters who say, oh, we're not going to have a break in the middle of a 2-hour session because people won't come back. And I think, oh no, that's not a problem. If you're being effective and engaging, they will come back and they will come back refreshed because of that. Some research I've seen suggests, at least at the college lecture level, the professor who put a lot of time into this said, after about 10 minutes, neurologically, people start to shut down and they need something to reboot them. So he played with that for a long time when he realized that sort of 10-minute rule he came up with. When he got to about 9 minutes and 50 seconds, he would either do a discussion or he'd put a different image on the wall or he'd change what he was doing, maybe show a short video. So there's always something to stimulate people. And I think that's a good rule of thumb. I tell you up front, honestly, that I don't know that that's a hard and fast rule you have to follow, because I have heard a lot of great presenters claim that they've read research showing in our era, if you go more than 3 minutes in a webinar or an online session without involving people, you've lost them. And yet I look at things like TED Talks, which are 18 minutes, and I rarely bail from an 18-minute TED Talk. So I don't think there's a hard and fast rule here that says every 5 minutes you have to change the look of your slides or show a video or ask a discussion question. But I think it's a combination of things, being aware that we do have limited attention span if we are not stimulating people. So that's the whole thing, engage, stimulate. And that's what Marcy noticed about what we're doing. I keep coming back to you saying, are you getting this? What questions do you have? If we were looking at the deck, you'd see that there are some that are full slide pictures with just a word or two on them. Others have discussion questions on, but you never quite know what's going to come next. And so you do pay attention because you know it's there for a purpose to keep you talking. And as we talk about the good, the bad, and the ugly of presentation, we want to look at what works for others and what works for us and be skeptical of any hard and fast rule that says every 10 minutes you must switch style, or every 3 minutes you must ask a question, or at the beginning of every session to break the ice, you have to ask what the weather's like where people are living. I mean, great. Asking people about the weather is a simple thing, but what does it have to do with what we're talking about? I'm much more interested from the very beginning of doing what I normally do. We have a large group coming in. We'll open the room 10 or 15 minutes online before the session starts. And we will, without making an announcement about it, we will start treating our virtual space as a virtual meeting room, just as at a conference, we would have some conversation before the session started. Personal observation here, you want to know what I think a great presentation is? A great presentation is one that starts the minute people start walking in the room, no matter what time the start time is formally announced as. And then when you reach that point on the clock that says the presentation started, you move into that so seamlessly, people don't even realize you've stopped talking at an informal level. Now you're starting to share material. And then it goes so that people are engaged and never have a chance to turn away and say, I want to leave because I'm bored. And no matter how many breaks you take, people are anxious to come back in and restart the conversation. And at the end of it, whether it was a half hour or 3 hours, at the end of it, people say, oh, I wish this were longer. You want to hear the best things you can hear as a presenter? I wish there were more. You know you've nailed it if you have given so much engaging information and kept your audience going with you, that regardless of how much time they spent with you, they want to spend more. That's when you know you did okay. Reactions, thoughts to that? Does that make sense to you?
Paul, I'll just add, the other thing in addition to wanting to stay, is when you look at your watch and realize you were in that room a lot longer than you thought you were, that it just went by quickly.
Yeah. Those of you in this session, do not look at your clocks yet. Cover your eyes. How long do you think we've been talking? Wild guess.
Since I looked at my clock, I'll volunteer. We started a few minutes late, so I'm going to say about 35 to 40 minutes.
Yeah, we're actually at about 50 minutes into it. So it's been about 45 minutes. And I think a couple of people were in right at 10. So we started a little bit of informal conversation. So some people have been going for 50 minutes. Does this feel like it's already been 50 minutes? That's how it should be for you. For those of you watching the archived version, even though you're not interacting with us, does it feel to you like it's been 50 minutes? If it has, I'm sorry, it shouldn't have been. But if you're surprised that you've been watching this video for 45 or 50 minutes and going, wow, that sure went fast, that's what you want to shoot for. And again, it's not difficult. It's what Marcy talked about, being empathetic, watching your audience, thinking about your audience, always thinking of it from their point. I talk about this in advocacy a lot, just as I talk about it in training. If you are, as an advocate, going out and talking about your library and all the wonderful things it does, I think you're missing a great opportunity as a presenter. A great presenter goes out and finds out what the audience is interested in, finds out what their pain points are, and starts to address those, and then finds the common ground between what your audience needs and what you can help provide or what you're seeking to do. And that is the sweet spot in advocacy as well as in learning. So think about your audience. Always make this audience-centric, learner-centric. There's a lovely term I picked up well over a decade ago from colleagues in learning online. They looked on their students, their learners, as co-conspirators in the learning process. We ought to do that with our advocacy too. When we're addressing ourselves as supporters and potential supporters, consider them playfully as the co-conspirators in the advocacy process and treat them as equals, not as people who came to you because you're wiser than they are or because you can show them all the things that they don't know. We learn from them, they learn from us. It's totally, I can't even think of the right word here, but everybody gets something out of it and everybody benefits. That's what we want to do as presenters. It's not about us, folks. It's about us being good enough to bring out the best in the people we're with so we produce something meaningful. Other questions or observations about all of this? The loaded question I was trying to ask a few minutes ago about, is this session different than others? I've alluded to it quite a bit, so it's not going to be any kind of a surprise to you that I feel this way. But when normally you come to a session like this online, most of us have PowerPoint decks that we start with from the very beginning, and we have those things on the screen for much of the interaction we have with people. Think about the impact of seeing slides that take up most of the landscape on the screen. And we as presenters are in a little corner box up in the left or right-hand corner. We may in Zoom see a few faces down the right-hand side. If we are smart enough to do it, we bring the chat window up so that people can be having back channel chats, but that takes up some more of the screen. And the effect is that the slides and the chat appear to be more important than the people that we're talking to. Compare and contrast that to what you've experienced here. I showed two slides just to make sure people had the name of the session and they had the Ursula Meyer write-up so they knew what kind of program we're doing and that there were more of these things out there. By the way, if you like this one, there are, I believe, already 6 previous sessions archived on the California Library Association YouTube channel. If you go to California Library Association on YouTube and look at the playlist, you'll see those, and this one will be added very soon. I think either Karen or Holly were with us today. So these are there for learning opportunities for you. That means that everything we do takes on a longer life. But let's take it to the moment of real importance here. How different would this have been if we spent the first hour with me as a little box, you weren't seeing each other, and we're just looking at slides, and you were hearing me drone on and on, compared to you can see each other, those of you that have your faces showing on screen. Think of how that creates for you a sense that you were with people and you're creating a connection, especially Larry and Marcy, who can see each other and haven't seen each other all the way through. They didn't know each other ahead of time. Now they have physically and audibly gotten to know each other. And if they run into each other at a conference or any other kind of a meeting, it's not going to be, oh, so nice to meet you. It's nice to see you again. We don't think about that until COVID. We didn't think about how many times we meet people and develop firm, long-lasting relationships in online settings if they are facilitated properly. I no longer have my vocabulary seeing somebody at a conference face-to-face on site. If I've been online with them a lot, saying, oh, nice to meet you. It's like, oh, good to see you here. But we know each other. That's not the initial meeting. And again, as advocates, you can do this. Derek Wolfgram at the 3-hour pre-conference session that we did on advocacy basics, I think that deck is either up or will be up on the CLA site, and I know it's on my website. We talked about the advantages that COVID has brought to a lot of people who never thought about Zoom or the other online platforms that we have. The time we save and not having to drive someplace, the kind of conversations we have where we can put our effort into meaningful actions rather than just getting there. Time and expense of money saved by doing these, if we do them properly and if we do them effectively, is a real godsend to us. And that's not something to overlook. If we had a larger audience, I'd ask the rhetorical question, who still believes that online or on-site always trumps online? I think when you sit, that's hilarious, still got his hand up. I'm not in that camp, but you know, it's still a good debate because especially in learning circles, we found online learning, if it's done right, and that's the big caveat, if online learning is done right, and it's effective, if it's done in the way that we're talking about it today, it can either match on-site learning or exceed it, depending on who's doing the work. So we can get past that. And I think we're going to see the same thing as more and more people get comfortable with Zoom, that if you have, Larry's putting a wonderful thing in there. We had a mock debate about there with Derek and me. Is it better to be on-site as an advocate or online? And Larry's comment is, Derek won that debate by about 10 points. I will quite frankly say, Larry, I thought that the moderator that we had said that it was kind of a draw and that her punchline was, depending on how you do it, they can be effective, but it also has to be that you're doing the right conversation in the right setting. But yeah, I mean, I sat there advocating for, oh yeah, online's every bit as good as on-site, and Derek was beating the pants off me for the most part. And I came back with a punchline at the very end of it that gave a very sympathetic moderator that out of saying, okay, you both made the point that each has its place. And that's really it. The whole debate about what's better, we need to get past that and just say, what serves our advocacy purposes best? One last example in that whole thing. I don't know if any of you are aware of Reverend Barber's thing that he picked up from Martin Luther King, the Poor People's Campaign. That is a magnificent thing. And I think they're about to go on site in Washington to do a major march that's supposed to rival the Martin Luther King March of the 60s. Barber and his colleagues with this National Poor People's Campaign were planning something like that, I believe in early 2020, and COVID shut it down. Did they shut down the operation? Heck no. They took it online. And a friend of mine had been telling me about the organization. I'd been watching them for some writing I was doing about advocacy. They did a weekend thing, which was a virtual march on Washington. They actually taped a program with live interviews and lots of music. And they put together a 2-hour program that was an online rally as if they'd been in Washington, DC. They had well over 1 million viewers by showing that thing 3 times in the same weekend. And I will say, you know, shame on our media for not having paid attention to that significant move, reacting to the fact that the Poor People's Campaign could not go to Washington. So they went to Washington virtually and they upped their involvement from people. They have a presence that's still out there if you go back and watch that rally. And I thought, you know, Reverend Barber and the rest of you, that is a stunning example to us of what's possible when we dream and we take advantage of stuff. They didn't say we're going to replace on site. They said, this is what we can do, and this is how we're going to do it, and we're going to stay with it. And that, to me, is a stunning example of the possibilities here. So I jokingly say, let's choose one over the other and argue until the cows come home that I think you can be effective in both. But it really comes down to, where's your audience? Where are you comfortable? And how can you do stuff that makes sense, that gets people to join the advocacy efforts that we are all fostering through the actions that we do as presenters and co-conspirators in the advocacy project? Larry, since you were there and you saw that mock debate, anything you want to add about what Derek and I were saying back and forth and what you walked away with in terms of perceptions?
Just to give background, and Paul, you alluded to it, Derek thought about the years he was on the advocacy committee and would go up to Sacramento for meetings, or in his case, over to Sacramento, and the time he spent in the car. I just looked at that differently. I looked at it, first of all, I had to fly up. But in flying, yeah, there's a little bit of hassle going through the airport. And certainly the trip to CLA proved that to be the case. But it's also me time. It's also time for me just to get away from the day-to-day pressures of the job, to prepare for the meeting, to go over the stuff that Dylan sent out. So to me, that wasn't a fair rationale why online might be better. Because in reality, you know, I'm answering the phone here because I'm the only one here today because we're close to the patrons today. So, you know, I keep getting interrupted, whereas traveling and then spending the night at a hotel and just, you know, getting ready and stuff. And I think some of it's just your attitude. You know, if you're going to think, oh, God help me, then yeah, it's probably, you could be doing it better online. But if you make use of it, and look at it from a different standpoint, because I still think, as somebody who went to an election night party last night, being able to talk to local electeds, you know, even if it was a brief conversation about, you know, when's the new streetlight going in or whatever the case is, you can't do that online.
Let us, you know, a good thing we can all start doing, and I include myself in this, is let's stop making a debate, is online better or is on-site better? Let us rephrase that question as, what are the advantages we have in any of those settings, and what can we do to recreate those advantages elsewhere? What Larry's talked about, I think, nails most conferences I've been to, but there are exceptions. And I look at the exceptions and say, why were they able to do it, and what can we do to move ourselves better? One that comes to mind is a group I mentioned earlier, Shaping EDU, an educational group out of Arizona State University. The mission of the organization is to try to reshape the face of learning in the digital era. And there are wonderful educators, wonderful consultants. We meet online an awful lot. Before COVID, we would try to meet at least once a year on Arizona State University's campus to have face-to-face meetings and then carry them back online. At our last meeting, we actually had sort of a hybrid where the main action was on site, but we had Zoom rooms set up. We had a variety of other ways for people offsite to communicate. And that served us well when COVID shut things down and a lot of the group members couldn't actually be there. We were technologically set up to have things. What I adored about some of the online things that we've done during the COVID era through Shaping EDU is we've recreated those social gatherings that Larry's talking about. We would do our work in the morning, take a 2 or 3 hour break in the afternoon, reconvene for a keynote around 5 o'clock Pacific time, which made it 8 o'clock Eastern time. And then for our colleagues in Europe and in Asia, they were up at the crack of dawn, but they wanted to be there. And the social events were lovely. Given how Zoom works, the guy on campus there that is a musician himself and knew a lot of musicians would set up an hour or two recital of local musicians coming to us all over the world out of Arizona. And through the chat, we could talk. And there was one night when I was attending one of those, listening to the music and chatting up friends who were also in the chat room, as if we were at a CLA or ALA conference, all going out to a nightclub together and having conversations. The chat one of my colleagues and I started to have was so rich and so deep. I started cutting and pasting the comments out of chat into a Word document. And as I was doing that, realizing I wanted to go back to it later, I thought, this is the same thing that would happen if I were on site face-to-face with people. We'd be having this conversation. I would start jotting down notes. When it was all over, I'd go back to my room and I'd stay up till the crack of midnight, writing a blog piece that would be up the next day for my fellow conference attendees. And because Arizona State, through that program, had so effectively set it up that we could communicate that way, I got that glimpse of what could be there. But understand what goes into that. As a presenter, if you're trying to foster that kind of thing, you have to have the technology in place. You have to be comfortable facilitating it. Your audience has to be comfortable using it, and they have to be willing to step out of the idea that, oh, we're not sitting shoulder to shoulder. We're virtually shoulder to shoulder. And then if that works, seeing the comfort level of it. So it's there, but we've got a long way to go. And it's good for all of us when we think about presentations to know what is capable, what is possible with the technology we're using, to think about our audiences and what their comfort level is, and make sure, again, as I said earlier, that the people are in the forefront and the technology facilitates the people interactions. Technology for me is at its best when we don't even pay attention that it's working. How many of us have sat here through this whole session this morning, and those of you watching the archive version, and said, oh, wow, this is really good because for the last 5 minutes I've been in Zoom. We don't care that it's Zoom. We care that we're talking to each other. We're interacting. Final observations or thoughts on that topic? Anybody? Or questions about how that works? In the second hour of this, we're going, the second hour of this, we're going to look over some of the techniques, things to think about in terms of how you prepare something. We'll workshop it a little bit. So by the end of the session, you do walk out with some kind of an outline for something you want to do. Let us take at least a 5 minute break here so you can get up and stretch. I'm going to keep my camera live. I'm going to keep the recording going. So if you have questions and you just want to chat, we don't lose that. But for those of you that want to step away for a few minutes, breathe, stretch your arms and legs so that you don't start to feel like, oh my gosh, this is just like painful to be sitting here. So 5 minute break, we'll be back at 10 after 11 our time zone here in California. See you in about five. Those of you that are still staying, it's like, oh, I don't want to leave. Anything informal you want to chat about while we're taking the break from formal presentation mode?
That was great. Wow.
Good. What do you like about it?
The whole point of interacting with the audience and finding out their needs first, because my first thing that I would do is probably read from my presentation in the PowerPoint. I like the part of having it, you know, in back of you, but using it as a tool and then interacting with your audience to find out their needs, but that seems difficult. You do that so well to blend it in, to have a conversation and talk about it and then you go back to the point that you were talking about. I'm gonna have to practice.
Exactly. That's the whole point, Marcy. Do not stand in awe of this. I struggle with it too. I try to make it look easy, but I struggle with it. Mm-hmm. My slide deck, I wanted to have this done a week ago. I was doing so many of the presentations at CLA that I was still up last night messing with it. And usually I would have sent this to Holly over at CLA the night before so she'd have it as a backup copy. I didn't send her the deck until almost 10 minutes before the presentation today because still looking at little things and saying, that could be better. I really do prefer to work in advance so that my last week or so, I just glance at things, I look it over. I do not stand in front of a mirror for hours on end practicing. What I do is if I've got a script in my speaker notes, I'll read those aloud so that the flow of the conversation strikes me as natural and I'll fine tune it based on where as I'm reading something. If I find myself stumbling, I'll break the sentence up. Or if I find myself adding a word that I hadn't inserted in the actual written text, I'll add it in at that point. Great tip I've learned from many writers is before you leave the room, read it out loud to see where the flaws are.
Okay.
I play with this nightmare situation once and once only. For a presentation I was doing in another city, I had all my stuff on my computer. I'm just obsessive about having backups. It's on my computer. I email myself a copy of the deck. I have it on a thumb drive. And if I've got other, before SlideShare changed its standards, I used to actually post on SlideShare. So I've had access to it. I'm just starting now because I revised the way I work my website and I load stuff up in the Dropbox for my website. So that's another backup. And I'm figuring, if all that fails and I have to present by candlelight, I'm ready to do that. I always have a printout of my presentations with the speaker notes so that if everything else goes wrong, I've still got that and I can deliver. But it's not easy.
I'm saying you're also a good listener, so you're able to debrief what people said and then feed it back in your own way.
Thanks. We can all do that. There's a slide in there that's something about listening as part of the whole presentation technique or presentation skills toolkit that we want to have. We don't listen very effectively in this country. Guilty as charged. We listen to half a statement and we start to plan our response and then we miss the other half of the statement. If we train ourselves to listen to a full statement and not fear the silence that comes after that, while we then formulate the response we're going to have, we do much better. But that fights against every role model we see. You watch anything on television, somebody's always jumping on somebody else to make the next point. If you're on social media, somebody tweets and you want to be the first one to tweet back. And we just have to slow it down, folks. Just because we can rush it doesn't mean we should. Other informal stuff. I'm just throwing it out to you since we're taking this informal break that nobody stepped away from. Look at this. Yeah, really? I hadn't planned it to be this way. But look at us. I gave you the option to turn off your cameras, walk away, go stretch. You know, the two of you that have been on camera the whole time, you didn't do that. I'm assuming Holly and Karen are still there. And I think Mila's probably still listening.
Well, I'm not sure where Molly might be, but I know Holly is here.
All right. Look at that. And Mila's got her thumb up.
I'm here.
That's the thing. When you have skeptical colleagues like I do, and you're planning a 2 or 3 hour workshop, and you say, we got to take some breaks in there, folks. People can't sit for 3 hours in front of a computer and feel comfortable. There have to be breaks. You go, what if they leave? And I go, if they leave, our fault, our bad. If we do our job right, they're not going to leave.
Advocacy is such a huge part of everything we do, regardless if it's with an organization, it's also with yourself. So learning how to do it in different formats, I think, is super important. So I know you don't see me all the time, Paul, but I am here and I am listening.
Yeah. Well, I assume you are because you know you're going to get the quiz afterwards. And if you...
That's true. I don't want to fail.
Dot, dot, dot. Yeah. Any other questions or observations? Here's a tough one for people to ask. We got the recording going, but let me just ask it. What could be making this particular session better at this moment? We must be having hearing problems here. I'm not hearing any responses. What could be making this session even more effective for you than it already is?
Well, I would volunteer having more people participating, but by the same token, I actually like, other than I feel I'm talking too much, the the here, I think Marcy in particular is more able to voice, and I'm learning quite a bit from her when I do get a chance to listen. So I'm really not sure anything would, every session's going to be different. And yes, this is different than the last session you did, but that's not a bad thing. And that doesn't mean it needs to be improved. My 84 cents.
That's fine. I'll take it. And I will spend it gladly at the first supermarket. It'll take your 84 and a half cents. Great point you're making there. I've told this story many times of a presenter I brought in when I was at San Francisco Public Library running the training program. 5 minutes, 10 minutes before the presentation, the person said, "Can't present today. You don't even have 10 people in the room." I said, "There is nothing in the contract that says you have a minimum audience. Every person in that room is important." He said, "Well, it's my standard to have a minimum of 10. I said, "A, you didn't say that to me. B, you're 10 minutes away from the presentation. If you walk from this presentation, you will never again present in this institution." And that was sobering to her. She said, "Well, this just isn't right." I said, "Fine. You need one more person. I'll go out and drag somebody in that will do this as a favor to me, but they're not interested in what you're saying. But if you need bodies, that's fine. The point is, we're not rock stars. I don't care if I've got one learner or I've got 500. For those of you sitting here with just a few of us in this room, you might think, "Wow, how can we do this with 500? I will tell you, Maurice Coleman, who's a great presenter, great colleague from the other side of the country. Maurice and I did a webinar many years ago for Web Junction. It was free, so a lot of people were in there. A lot of people knew us. We had over 500 people. We're both looking at each other going, how is this going to work? Not only did it work because we had a great producer, great tip here, when you're going to do something like this, the Hollies and the Karens who were on these calls to produce and troubleshoot for us, free us up to do our jobs as presenters. But when you have a great troubleshooter and a great producer there, it works. And the way we made 500 or more people work in that session is, when Maurice was talking, I was monitoring chat and I would jump in when there was a question that really tied into what he was talking about and make sure we answered that. Look at that smile from Molly. Yes, we love our producers. And Maurice would do the same for me. When I was talking, he would look, and our producers would also do the same thing. The chat was moving so fast. It was like a comic thing where you just couldn't see everything. It was going so fast. And here was the clincher, wonderful moment at the end. Somebody, as we were saying, "So how was that for you?" We got a couple comments saying, "We don't know how you did it, but it was amazing how you answered every question." Now, the stunning truth was, of course, we didn't answer every question. But Maurice and the producer and I were spotting trends in the questions. So if 10 or 15 people asked the same thing, we found a way to get that question out as one question. And people walked away with the illusion that we had actually answered every question, except for those people who were not kind enough to say, "You answered every one. Why didn't you answer mine?" But it's an interesting thing as a presenter. Again, you just take what you work with, what you're given, and work with it to the best of your ability, and you look for ways to make it better afterwards. So you always ask that kind of question I ask with the camera running: what could make this session better? You're all sweet enough to say, "This is pretty good," and make the observations Larry made. But if there had been something that was stunningly on point as a facilitator who values the people that he works with, I would have said, "Yeah, let's do that." I would have found a way to incorporate that into the second half. So always check, make sure your audience is with you. Look at what's going on. Listen to what's happening. If you see people voting with their feet by leaving a room or they're logging off, you know that there's a problem, and you better stop and say, "Okay, before I lose the rest of you, what is it that I'm not doing that you needed?" And that takes us back into the second part of this. I'm going to break out of the pattern we've been doing so far to run a few slides. And again, take advantage of the thing I showed you at the very beginning as another presentation tip for you if you're using Zoom. While we're talking, I'm not sure what's showing up on your screen, but what I'm seeing is I'm switching over to a presenter mode within Zoom. It's under the advanced settings, and it allows me to bring up a slide deck as a background. So while I'm talking to you and running through this, I'm frantically trying to get that slide deck up, which I think I've just about managed to do, except now I heard the little button saying to press the wrong button. And there we are. Presto Zappa, we're back to the very first slide, and we're creating that illusion that we are in a room with my slide deck behind me, and I'm still talking to you. If you want to know how to do this, I just clicked on the screen and it brought up that little box. I practiced this ahead of time. That's the key here. You practice this until the cows come home. I found the right position. I could make myself tiny, but that kind of ruins the point. So I made myself by grabbing that upper left arrow with my cursor and positioning it. So I'm taking up a good part of the screen. I actually did run through the deck a little bit to make sure that the slides worked with my face in there. And you'll see me a few times adjust myself because I know that not all the slides are perfect. But as a presenter, if you're going to do this mode, which I think is a really interesting way to go and keep interactivity, you do a run through. And I'm going to zap through this just so that you can kind of get a sense. Oh, there we go. That's what I wanted to get to. These slides I've used in webinars where I'm in a little box in the corner. I've used these live in a few presentations, and now I'm hoping that it comes across really effectively face-to-face online as you see the slide and you don't lose sight of the fact I'm there. And certainly with this group this small, you are not losing sight of the fact that there are other people in the room. Now, I think those of you watching the archive recording may not see that there are little thumbnails across the top of our screen where we can still see each other. And that is a flaw to doing this. As a presenter, if you know that part of your audience and the significant part is going to be the audience watching afterwards, you do not want to do this because you don't want to turn it into a lecture. You still want to create the illusion, at least, that there were people there paying attention. So all that said, as a big tip to you, here's another way you can present and keep things lively. If you're going to use slides, A, make sure that they're dramatic, wonderful pictures that make you look and go, I will remember that. Just a few words. You can see already the format I'm going to follow here. I'm going to go through a little list of presenter attributes that I want to leave you with. Again, you don't have to be taking notes here. You have access to the deck. It is a resource. It's sort of what I'm taking from Tom Hames, who does his stuff on his site and incorporates it into presentations. I hope this is clicking for you as an idea that's worth playing with. Attributes, preparation. I just talked about all the preparation that went into this. If I'm doing something where I'm on site, and I'm bringing in other presenters from an online setting elsewhere in the country, I want to make sure I have practiced that in the room I'm using with the laptop I'm going to be using. I want them coming into the practice session with their laptop and exactly the same lighting they're going to be using. And I want to look for blind spots in the room where if we're showing a camera to the person who is coming into us from a distance, using the camera on our laptop to let them see what's happening in the room. I want to look for the blind spots, like a window in the back of the room that makes everybody look like they're in a witness protection program. That's all the prep that goes into making something like this happen. And I cannot speak highly enough of the hours of preparation to go in the first time you do this, because then it becomes easier and easier over a period of time and the prep time gets a little bit less, but it's always there. I am trying, and again, total disclosure here, as I'm going through this, if I see a problem, I'm going to point it out to you. I was trying to hit the down arrow to move the slides, and I'm just realizing again, in this particular Zoom presenter mode, I have to go to what I'm seeing on my screen that allows me to advance the slide by clicking there. So another attribute, enthusiasm. I hope there has not been a single moment in this presentation when you didn't feel as if I was anything less than 1,000% excited about being with you and talking about this topic, because I think it's important. I think it's important to you. And punchline is, I think that we can make a difference with what we're doing here. If you become a better facilitator and presenter in online settings, you're going to be a better advocate and you can produce the kind of results you want to produce in the communities you serve. We have to be flexible. And again, I'm just looking at that slide and thinking, all right, I want to position myself so that you can actually see the best part there. There's nothing wrong with doing that. You don't necessarily have to point out to your audience that you're doing it, but because we are in more or less a training session on this, I want you to see what I'm doing and how I'm reacting. But being flexible to what's going on around you is really important. And the underlying theme here is don't let anything totally throw you. If your slides suddenly go wonky, fine. You go back to gallery view. If suddenly your camera goes out and all people are seeing is your logo, fine. You keep talking. The show's got to go on. You only bail when the situation's so bad that you cannot effectively do things. And then you mercifully pull the plug and say, folks, unfortunately, we just don't have the setup to do this. We'll do a follow-up with you immediately and let you know when we're coming back. But short of that, you look for that graceful sense of flexibility that runs through the best of what we do and keeps us tied into what our audiences want and expect from us. Okay, shifting again, curiosity. Oh, nice kitty, nice kitty. This cat, which unfortunately just lost recently. We're still kind of grieving her, but she was the most affectionate, curious thing. She would get into any space and you can see her looking at me and going, will you speak faster? I'm getting bored with you right now. But she would just get into spaces and figure things out. And she just was intuitive in everything she did and inspired us through her actions. We want to be as facile, and I hope as cute and as adorable and as engaging as that cat in the sink is. We want our curiosity to take us places with the people that are looking to us to help them with their advocacy so that, again, the bottom line is our causes are promoted effectively and we produce concrete results. kind of shift again. So you see the whole thing here with the guy with his computer, his Apple computer with all the apples in front of it. This was not staged. I saw this in a library. I think it was in Chicago when I was at a conference there. And I thought, okay, A, that guy was really thinking to have some fun putting those apples in front of his Apple computer. And B, as somebody who's a presenter, I was thinking, that is a stunning image. I don't know how I'm going to use this, but I'm going to use that at some point. So I walked over and asked him, do you mind if I take this? And I told him what I do. I said, do you mind if I use this? I want to have the ability to just use this in slide decks. And he was fine. Go ahead. Just leave me alone. Let me eat my apples. We often, in trying to put slide decks together, struggle to find images that reflect what we're doing. And I'll tell you, build up your library over a period of time. Use your smartphone, use your tablet to take pictures of anything you see. Do not just take pictures of the things that appeal to you and that you want at that moment. If there's a striking image, take the picture like I did there, saying, I will find a use for this later, but I'm building up my library. You'll see in this particular deck, I think probably about 50% of the pictures are things I took, and about 50% of them are things I took from Flickr, making sure I'm doing proper attributions. I don't want to get into copyright laws. So when I'm doing a Flickr search, I search for things that are Creative Commons and allow you to use them in any way you want, including recropping them and using them for commercial purposes. Be very careful, because you can get burned if you use a copyrighted image and somebody comes after you looking for fees later. Another service that I've been using more and more these days is one called pixabay.com, P-I-X-A-B-A-Y. Pixabay is fabulous. I think they're a subset of Getty Images. Pixabay will put out lots of really high quality images that are free. You don't even have to put attributions, although the photographers' names are often listed in there. And just to stay on the right side of it, when I put together a deck, I'll have a final slide. There's the attribution deck, and I'll put the photographer's name, credit it to Pixabay, and actually put the URL in back to the image so people can see where it was. I'm doing the photographer the favor of saying, if you like this guy's work, go look at it here. If you like this woman's work, go look at her there. And let's be fair about that. But at the same time, let us use images that really get us there and show the kind of detail to presentation that we want to have. I keep forgetting here, total disclosure, I keep forgetting I go to reach down to one button and then realize it's the other one. Here we go back to what I mentioned earlier, that whole listen, understand, and act. There's that word listen. If we listen, we become more effective in what we do. And as advocates, we do need to be listening to people and make sure that we're hearing what they need, and realizing if we're going too far down a road that's taking us where they don't want to go, that we don't do that. Facilitation is a whole topic that we could do hours and hours of sessions on, but it really comes down to, again, using your listening skills, having a strong set of ideas in mind as to what you're there for and what the goals are for your session, making sure that people have an opportunity to be heard without letting any one person dominate an entire conversation. Larry was very sensitive and empathetic earlier, expressing a concern that he was talking too much. Larry has added stuff that is exactly where we needed to be, and many of your participants will do that. When somebody starts to go too far, you can just gently say, okay, we've got on now. Given the limited time we have, let's hear from a few other people. And I know this is hard for a lot of people, but I've just learned from experience, if you don't facilitate effectively, you lose your audience, you waste people's time, and nobody walks away happy. So as hard as this is, in radical situations where somebody starts to talk too long and you need to rein it back in, I start by saying, I'm sorry, we're out of time for that. We need to move on. And the person says, I just want to say one more thing. And I will just stick with that line rather than getting argumentative. I say, I'm sorry, we're out of time. But can I say one more thing? No, I'm sorry, we're out of time. We're going to move on. And if they keep going, I'll start to talk over them and bring the next person in. Now that's hard. And that sounds cruel. But that's only cruel to the person that just wants to say one more thing. To the rest of the people in that room, that is an act of grace. That is an act of something that respects their time and their efforts. And as hard as that is to do, you really have to remember, as a facilitator, that's your responsibility. If you find that a hard thing to do, practice it. Work with people who can encourage you, and think about the impact of the positive impact you play by doing that. And finally, everything we're talking about today comes back to the idea of collaborating. Larry, I think, said, or it was Marcy, I'm sorry I'm mixing up some of the conversation now, but somebody mentioned a little earlier the idea that we kept coming back to learning from each other. And it was Larry saying he was learning from listening to Marcy. And that comes out of our advocacy sessions too. When we listen to people and we share things, we take the pressure off ourselves as presenters. We don't have to know it all. We do not have to be at the center of attention at all moments. In fact, the more we can disestablish a front of the room and make everybody in the room somebody who's important and a contributor to the conversation, the closer we are to the true spirit of advocacy and what has to happen there. Questions or reactions to what we just looked at in terms of some of the attributes I see in the great presenters that I work around, what I try to incorporate into my own work? Who's going to break the silence? You know, there are times when you do not fear the silence and you don't let it be uncomfortable. Another aspect of presentation and learning, time for reflection. When we stop and put in those pauses that I'm artificially creating right now, they give you that time to breathe and to think and to absorb. That's why we take breaks. And sometimes people do walk away and you shut down for 5 or 10 minutes. But it's also why even doing the kind of break we did where we continued to talk at an informal level, those are useful moments. And we need to build those into our conversations. We need to build those into the activities that we do. We have to make sure that they are meaningful for the people we work with. All right, so rubber hits the road here. There's a lot more we could talk about. And again, the slide deck has lots and lots of other tips and tricks that you can have. But remember, when you're in the role of facilitating sessions, whether you're presenting or you're training or doing anything else that's going to lead to action and advocacy, people can only remember so much. The research that I read says, if you're doing a training session, you're lucky if people walk away with 3 big concepts that they can remember. And you're really lucky if, in addition to those 3 main concepts, they can gather 3 or 4 subsidiary things that are tied back into those main themes. So if that's the case, there's no point for us in a 2-hour session to have a new slide up every 30 seconds filled with information and all kinds of tips, and then expect people at the end of it to walk away anything other than muddled and confused about what they were supposed to have. It should be clear to you at this point in our session, and now we're about 3/4 of the way through it. Yes, indeed, we've been together for 90 minutes. It should be clear to you that I keep coming back to what I think are the essentials, that it's the people connections, it's the collaborative skills. It's the ability to look at your audience and understand what they want and what they need and be very focused in your goals so that if there is a clear point to your presentation and a clear point of asking for the action that you want. That's as clear and concise a summary as I can give you briefly of what I've been trying to get across through our conversation and through the slides and through everything else that I've done with you for these 90 minutes. So let us workshop this. Mila, can you unmute so that we can actually hear? In fact, the 3 main people, I would not mind also if Karen and Holly want to get involved in this, but particularly Larry, Marcy, and Mila. Let's get to the point now where you start thinking about a cause in which you have a stake in being an advocate. Identify that for yourself. I'm going to give you a few seconds. For those of you watching the archive version, think of something that you really love and that you want to be an advocate for, or that you're already involved in. If you're already in it, you're further down the road here. I'm going to do something I normally don't do. I'm going to just go around this very small room here, at least with the 3 main participants we have here, and ask you to make sure we're on track. Marcy, what is the thing that you want to be an advocate for?
I want to be an advocate for reducing the digital divide between computer users, because I believe that there are different levels. You know, some people, and we've learned that through the pandemic, where, you know, some people had the basic skills to use their own devices, but weren't able to use other devices. So that became an issue.
Wonderful. Larry, an issue on your advocacy side that you're really concerned about right now and want to focus on?
A little different take on what Marcy just said. I would say universal broadband, and then secondly, state funding for county law libraries. And I'm sure you can't imagine why I said that one.
No, we'll have to talk about that after the session today. Mila, is there anything for you that is an issue that you really want to put your advocate chops into?
I don't think I'm prepared for this interactive of the session as well, because, you know, I guess the library in general, because, you know, I work in a library right now, and I think my top priorities is trying to get people to come back to the library more than anything. It's probably more of reintroducing the library service. But I think my reason for joining the session was kind of just to learn more than anything.
Let me see if I can flip this just a little bit to lead you down this path. That's not a bad one. If that's what we're going to stay with, that's fine, because it has to be something from the heart. But you look around your community as somebody working in a library. What is one thing in your community that really bothers you that you wish was different?
Well, that they don't know about the library, really.
And let's flip it now. Them not knowing about the library, what's one big problem that causes for them?
I guess they're missing out on the resources that we provide. Because, you know, pre-pandemic, when we did our outreach, a lot of comment that we often hear is, you know, people from the community going to, let's say, the library's booth and finding out, oh, you have, you know, I don't know, you have movies. They thought like libraries just have books, like you can borrow DVDs, or you can do digital stuff as well. So it's that, I think, primarily.
Watch what I'm doing here, all of you, because this is how you find that advocacy thing that puts it back on the people you're at. You've started to take us down a road that's going to be very fruitful. The pandemic, movies. What were we reacting to when people needed movies and they weren't getting them in pandemic terms?
Sorry, could you repeat that
again? Yes, you talked about the pandemic. You wanted people to know that you had movies. What was the problem that you were trying to address by saying to people, you can see movies here? Why would they need movies from the library?
Well, I guess to, you know, provide them with an option, like, you know, here's a free resources that's already available in the community. So especially if you're financially strapped, like, you know, you can still have variety of options available at your home without, like, you know, forking out for multiple streaming subscriptions or, you know, things like that.
Good. Okay, we're going to fast track this. Normally in something like this, a great facilitator takes the time to ask about another 5 or 6 questions to get you to the punchline. You've given me enough here to do that. Pandemic, people watching movies. Why is that important? Because people may not have the money to get entertainment. What's the underlying problem? They're isolated. There are resources out there that could help them. But the problem from their point of view is they're suddenly at home without being able to go to movies, without getting entertainment, without doing other things that are important to them. And a library can sort of take away that pain. So with advocates, when I work with people to try to get them to the advocacy issue and put it in terms of the people they're serving, we totally ignore the idea that you should know about the library. From the library's point of view, that's the advocacy issue. From the point of the community, the issue is people are isolated. They may not have the resources financially or time-wise to be able to get entertainment, to plug those gaps at a time when they really need entertainment and need a sense of community. So what you're really tackling is, if you wish you had more entertainment things during the pandemic, here's one way you can go. We'll work with you to get those resources in your hands, and not going to cost you anything other than the tax dollars you're already putting into it. See where I'm going with that, Mila?
Yeah, definitely.
Good. Yeah. That's what we want to do as advocates. It's the hardest thing in the world. As a trainer, the first thing I want to talk about is training and how great it is. But that's the worst thing to talk to people who want to learn. As advocates for libraries, we want to talk about our libraries, how great they are. That's not where the action is. The action is, what is somebody hurting from? Where if they knew about us, the pain would be less. Or if we collaborate with them, we could take it away a little bit. Marcy was talking about the whole idea of digital divide. I mean, you could go in and find some really wonderful, engaging stories about what the digital divide causes to people, but you're not going to win people over as advocates in your role as an advocate by saying the library is really good at dealing with the digital divide. It's going to start with you saying, you're probably feeling left out because you don't have great access to the internet. You may have bandwidth problems. That takes us into what Larry was talking about too. When we put it in their terms and we say, we are working on that and we need your help to work on it too, so that you can have better broadband and you can have access to stuff that no longer makes you feeling like you're on the wrong side of a divide. Or going back to your case, Mila, we want to talk to you about what we can do to plug that gap of you're isolated and you don't have the money to rent from Netflix or to pay your cable bill or any of that stuff. You don't need that. Well, actually, if you're going to be looking at movies online, you do need broadband access. So that wasn't the best example I could come up with. But you can tell people, if you do need access to these things and you can't go out and buy movies through Netflix, at least with an internet connection, you can get access to a library. That's our starting ground. Everybody with me so far on this? Simple framework here. Let me look at my notes here. I know I put it up toward the very end and I don't want to waste time bringing a slide up, but four things to think about as you write your presentation outlines, which we're going to do over the next few minutes. The starting point, you may want to take notes on this. The starting point is the action that you want to inspire. Marcy and Larry, if you're going to focus on broadband and digital divide, figure out that one little thing that people in your community can do now that would take them one step closer to overcoming the digital divide with you as a partner. And Mila, think about one little step you can take that would get people's attention to the idea that they're suffering because they can't get access to resources they can't afford to pay for. And yet here we have them at the library free of charge. The second of the four things is the impact your work will have on your community. So you work with us on this, what difference is it going to make? Have that in your mind so you can translate to people. The third thing will happen is that you want to focus on is what might happen if you are not successful. For those of you that don't have access to movies, you're still not going to have access to movies. You may feel further and further isolated. For those suffering from the digital divide, it's going to get worse. You're never going to overcome that. If you don't have broadband, you're left in the dust. You cannot find work. You cannot do some of the learning opportunities like this one that you have access to. We're talking about digital divide and all this and how great it is we can do online learning. But if our members of our community can't even plug into this program live or in the archive version, it's not doing them any good. So what might happen if you're not successful? And finally, what to do next? It is your call to action. When you're an advocate, you don't just talk about how great the cause is. Say, okay, everybody, that's great. Send me an email afterwards. You want to put out, if you are with me, here's what we need to do next. Talk to me. It has to be that explicit. A little bit of other background. We've talked about storytelling in other sessions. And next month, second Wednesday of July, our session will be a 90-minute session on storytelling and advocacy. It's going to be a longer workshop version of what we did at the California Library Association in a 45-minute version. So if you're at CLA, this isn't going to be anything new to you. But if you weren't at the CLA conference, join the club. We'll have more leisurely time to look over the essence of storytelling. What I will tell you today is, when you are starting as advocates and doing your presentations, you do not want to spend the first 10 minutes talking about where the bathrooms are and how to contact us later and where the slide deck's going to be. You want to start with the killer story that draws you in. If you go back and look at the beginning of this session, you realize once we got started, one of the first things I did was tell you the story of D. Ray McKesson and how he went from being an educator to an activist by going to Ferguson, tweeting things out and saying, this feels right. I can do more of this. You always want to start with that story that sets the context and draws people in and gives them a visceral understanding of what the issue is. Are we clear on the concept then? Presentation, start with the story. They've got four elements: the action you want to inspire, the impact your work is going to have on the community, including the people you're talking to, what might happen if you're not successful, and what to do next. Take a few minutes, jot down some notes of an outline, taking the theme you laid out for me. And Karen and Holly, if you're working, well, I know Holly, you're about to go into a position where you're doing advocacy. Use this same situation with those rules. Let's take about 5 minutes. When you've got your outline done, tell me, and we'll debrief those together and see what we can do to make them even better. In the meantime, I will sit here for a few minutes just looking at the camera and enjoying this. If you have questions, ask, put them into the chat. Those of you watching the archive version, you might want to fast forward a little bit until you see us actually start to talk again, or just freeze it and do your own writing so that you can come back to it and pick it up. online presenter tip, by the way. When you do this kind of exercise, do the same thing you do in a room. If your group was working, you were in the front of the room, I'd be walking around a little bit, looking over people's shoulders. I'm not going to really look over shoulders right now, but I'm taking time to glance at the notes I have to make sure that in the last few minutes, I'm ready to take us home the way we want to be taken home. So you do that and don't worry about it. Okay, let's be merciful to the people that are watching the archived version. Holly, can you pause it at this point? I'll give you a thumbs up when we're ready to come back into conversation. So we're back after a brief break there. Those of you watching the archived version, I would just tell you that the jokes got so funny that we actually lost one of our participants. No, actually, we just did a little bit of workshopping there. We're going to come back now for the official debrief. The person who had to leave early because of other commitments. So Larry, you want to go first in terms of the thing that, did we just lose one person? We lose a couple. Oh no, Mila's still there. I'm sorry. I see the black box at the bottom. Larry, what do you have in terms of your outline?
Oh, I'm going to have to pass. That entire break, I answered phone calls.
Fair enough. Mila, do you have anything that you want to share in terms of the outline you put together?
Thank you, Paul, for helping with the story part. So I guess in terms of the subject, we're trying to get people to help with our advocacy and getting more people know about the entertainment option provided by the library. So we could start something with, you know, especially we notice in our community that a lot of people are not fully aware of the services that is provided by the library. So one of the things that we know people were impacted, especially during the pandemic, is they don't have access to a lot of entertainment option unless they are able to pay for certain services. So I think during the pandemic, the library was able to provide those streaming services for free to our community to help them, supplement their entertainment option. So if we get more support to it, then we will be able to reach out to more people in our community. And kind of like equalize access to entertainment, I guess, for different parts of our community that might have different financial burdens, I guess. I guess the next steps to encourage people to help us advocate this cause is kind of like, help us share the services that you use at the library. Like if we post on our social media about our services, help share the post to your social media so that more people know about it in our community.
What I really like about this, and those of you that were not in the live version, were watching the archive version, there was a brief conversation while the camera was off. We talked about what's a story you've heard from somebody about the impact on them, a positive impact from having access to those movies. That's where you really want to put it. You hit that pain point, and you come back to what Mila did so well at the very end of this. Help us to get the word out so that we can help more people to take advantage of this. Again, our advocacy is about taking away their pain point. And if in the meantime, it helps the library too by drawing more people in to show that it's a vital, vibrant institution that's meeting a dramatic community need, so much the better. But really, as advocates, we're looking at their pain and what we can do to draw them in to something that gives them a positive response to something that hurts. That's the essence of what we're doing. Holly, is there anything from your outline you wanted to go over?
I still need to really think about it because it's coming at it from a place where I have to refamiliarize myself with this group. But the key thing that I'm working on is EDI issues. So for me, it's about how to build understanding and community in a new space for people who haven't had that either opportunity to learn or train there? And how do I help the community engage and learn and move forward with that?
And what's the action you're asking those people to engage in?
I'm asking them to be open, receptive, and understanding on how whatever it is that we develop will help and benefit our industry and organization.
Beautiful. All right. What unanswered questions do you have about the process we've been talking about? You're all brain burned, right? That was a lot to cover. But I hope, even though it was a lot to cover, that there was something sequential that you can latch on to. You know, we looked at that image at the very beginning of that hand reaching out and grabbing a real hand out of a computer screen. And the essential thought there is, if we're really good about this online and on-site interactions in activism, that is the funny and yet from the heart version of what we're trying to do as presenters. It really all comes down to the human connection again. And if we don't lose sight of the human connections that are possible in these settings, then we have created yet another element of our toolkits to be more effective in serving communities. It's all about positive change. It's all about transformation. And as presenters, that's our role. We need to lay that out, invite people in, and then take advantage of the fact that we have more supporters so we can all work together and celebrate the successes that we have. That really is the essence of what we talked about. Slide deck, which will be available to you later, does include a bunch of resources. Some of them are very much training oriented, but they're books about how to create online communities for training purposes. If you read a little bit between the lines, you can actually translate that into the kind of thing we're talking about today. Also, one of the books I put in there is the TED Talks book by Chris Anderson, who's the head of TED. Again, going back to something I said at the beginning, people say that if you go too long, you lose interest, and yet TED Talks hold people's interest for 18 minutes. To be frank, a 2 or 3 hour movie holds your interest. Why? Because it's engaging, it's compelling. The wonderful book, TED Talks, the official TED guide to public speaking, takes you start to finish through what TED encourages people to think about in terms of presenting their stories, getting them out there in an effective way, how to present, how to take advantage of the technology you have and the setting you have to make those connections that are transformative. And if you walk away with just one thing from today's session, I hope that one thing was the idea that with the tools and the advocacy support groups that we have through CLA and other organizations, we have a lot to work with and we can all get better at this. I'd encourage you to take advantage of the things that are on the CLA website. There's a whole advocacy tools page that has lots and lots of links. Keep coming back to these monthly sessions and encourage your friends to do the same thing. The more the merrier. We're happy to have you. One last round before we close it out. Any questions or comments from those of you that have stayed with the live session? All right, my standard question. We're down to Mila and Larry and subsidiary there, Holly. What's one thing you'll do differently in the next week as a result of the conversation we had today?
Mine's going to be taking pretty much everything you've been teaching us up till today and learning how to use these skills to communicate better, to hopefully draw up a better plan that I can present to the key people that need to be buying in so that we can move it forward together.
Wonderful.
Well, Paul, since you don't like silence, I'll respond by saying I'm not sure I'm going to do anything different, but more importantly, continue the process that I have been doing and hope to continue doing for a while.
Fair enough. Mila, you get to close it out. Anything you're going to do differently as a result of having been here?
I guess trying to frame the story better. Like, especially in terms of advocacy, because again, you did it very well, Paul, but I think it's a shift for me trying to figure that one out. So probably learning that a little bit more.
Wonderful. All right. Thanks, everybody. Thanks, CLA, for continuing the Ursula Meyer training series that we're doing. Hope to see you again in future sessions. Well, if you want to close out the recording, I'll stay online if anybody has some questions that they wanted to ask that were not, that they didn't want included in the recording, and then we'll say goodbye for the day.